This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news and intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversations. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the views of the management and staff of Guardian Radio.
This is Dr. Greggory Pinto, a Bahamian urologist, and this is Urology Speaks. It's my pleasure to have in studio today the esteemed gastroenterologist, Bahamian Dr. Gemma Roll, who also happens to be the MAB president. We're going to be speaking everything about gastrointestinal issues, which would afflict men, women, children of all ages, and it's an overwhelming problem. Unfortunately, we're having an upsurge in colorectal cancers in this country, particularly for younger adults, less than 55 years old. Those numbers have doubled even throughout the United States since the 1990s, and there are many reasons for that, which we'll discuss with Dr. Gemma Roll. But my brother is also a gastroenterologist, so I know the arduous, difficult road to becoming one, so I have the greatest respect for you, and welcome to The Urologist Speaks.
Good evening, and thank you for having me, Dr. Pinto. It's wonderful to be here. I feel honored.
So let's start with the simple things. Let's talk about hemorrhoids. So it's a very common issue. What causes hemorrhoids? How do we treat hemorrhoids? When do we medically manage them, and when do we surgically manage them?
Oh, whoa, that's a loaded, you know, question. Way to start. So hemorrhoids are located at the rectum, the anorectal junction. So you have inside the rectum, you can have internal hemorrhoids. Outside the anus, you can have external hemorrhoids. People may notice that there may be perhaps a bulge at the anus or some itching they may experience or even bleeding. Hemorrhoids can bleed. So they're essentially dilated vessels in the rectum, in the pelvis. Or straining to have bowel movement, or sometimes straining when you're lifting heavy objects or weights.
Right? And then, of course, they're internal and external.
Right.
Which type is more symptomatic, or does it not make a difference?
Both can be have their own set of symptoms. Internal hemorrhoids can prolapse, and you can perhaps feel them on the outside. A lot of people don't know that they have internal hemorrhoids until perhaps they have a rectal exam or a colonoscopy, and you can actually see them. Most people, I guess, would be familiar with the external ones because they're the ones that you can actually see from the outside and feel.
And then, of course, we all know about preparation aids. There are numerous commercials throughout the years and other local preparations used to manage and treat hemorrhoids. How effective are those versus oral medications such as the medication Daflon?
Oh, it's a heavy question. So Daflon is this kind of weird drug that we cannot really relate perhaps the exact mechanism of action, why it is helpful for bleeding hemorrhoids. So Daflon is indicated for hemorrhoids that bleed. The over-the-counter ointments that you can get, like the preparation H or perhaps Anusol, that you would insert a suppository, or you can place a cream around the anus. These are for hemorrhoids that are inflamed. You may have some itching. They shouldn't be used for long term, right? You should just use them as needed, maybe when you have a flare. I think focus should probably be directed towards how do we prevent a flare of external hemorrhoids. So good toileting habits, cleaning, the anus after a bowel movement.
There is one dangerous trend that I see as a physician, a urologist, a surgeon in this country, and even in other countries that I've worked, and that's for patients to assume, or just a general population to assume, every time they see blood, right, and they dismiss it as something benign that will go away, or they'll treat themselves, or just get a preparation H. What is the danger of that? I mean, blood per rectum, whether it's dark blood, digested blood, whether it's bright red blood, what are the potential causes, and why is it so dangerous to ignore those symptoms and to assume, and in unfortunately many circumstances, wrongly assume that it's attributed to hemorrhoids?
Okay, so I'm happy that you asked that question, because any opportunity that I get to speak about rectal bleeding, I would let you know that rectal bleeding is never normal. Okay, it's not safe to assume that all blood from the rectum is from hemorrhoids, and it's even more dangerous when you are, if your primary care physician or your healthcare provider would perpetuate that, even without examining the patient or getting a history that you're bleeding from hemorrhoids. Have myself and other gastroenterologists met with patients who have been treated for hemorrhoids by their physician for quite some time, present with a rectal cancer that may be advanced stage? Yes, I think we've all seen it one too many times. So rectal bleeding is never normal.
And then when we talk about melena stools, black stools, tarry stools that have that very characteristic odor, what are the causes of melena or black stools?
So totally different topic. We're off the topic of hemorrhoids now, because melena, black stool, tarry stool, this suggests bleeding from somewhere in the upper digestive tract, perhaps the stomach, or mostly the stomach or esophagus. Stools would be black, slick, tarry-like, foul-smelling. And the reason for this is because blood that mixes with the acid or digestive juices from the stomach, it turns it black. And so stool would come out black.
And then again, a lot of patients realize that because they might have stomach indigestion. They may have acid reflux.
They may have epigastric
pain.
Yeah.
And then they'll be overdosing themselums on Dyka, on Tums. They may borrow their neighbors or their cousins' proton pump inhibitors, Nexium, Losec. What is the role of, when we talk about acid reflux, when we talk about GERD, does that predispose us to getting upper GI cancers?
Ooh, boy. Not necessarily, though if you have had chronic upper digestive symptoms, dyspepsia, indigestion, nausea, what you deem as heartburn, acid, the term acid reflux is thrown around a bit without defining it, but any chronic upper GI symptoms can either be the mark of something really bad happening, or if it's gone on long enough, may have a pre-malignant condition that, if unchecked, could lead to cancer, right? So that there's two parts to it. One, the onset of this, especially in a certain age demographic, it could be a sign that there is something wrong. And then in another demographic, you'd have these symptoms going on for such a long time that you would wonder if, you know, this is something that is unchecked and it's caused to or allowed to fester, it can turn into something more.
I mean, there are hundreds of Bahamians and residents who basically
have
gas, indigestion.
Yeah, gas that moves to the head and causes headache even.
Correct. Yeah. So, I mean, in the last 20 years, there's been a link between Helicobacter pylori, H. pylori, which is commonly known, and gastritis, inflammation, peptic ulcer disease, and then ultimately possible increased risk of gastric cancer.
Mm-hmm.
What is the role of eradicating H. pylori?
Oh, my goodness. Doc, you are just hitting me with it. So I'm happy that you brought up H. pylori. I write a prescription at least once or twice a day in the office for what we call triple therapy for H. pylori. In fact, it's probably quadruple therapy at this point. But for the most part, it requires three medications to treat. H. pylori is like ubiquitous, it's like everywhere, right? It can cause a plethora of symptoms. H. pylori itself, like you said, Helicobacter pylori, is a bacteria. It's a special kind of bacteria because it lives in the stomach. And when you think about what the stomach does, the stomach is where the acid is. That's where all the bacteria that you may consume from contaminated food gets their first line of defense. They get hit with the acid in the stomach. But this bacteria is able to bury its way into the stomach, and live in an acidic-rich environment, and then it just wreaks its havoc, okay? It causes lots of inflammation. It can cause anemia. It can cause changes in bowel habits, abdominal pain, peptic ulcer disease. And so when a patient comes in with upper GI symptoms, that's one of the first things that we kind of think of, and we want to test for it. And there's various ways to test for it, depending on what other symptoms are happening.
Is there a breath test?
So there's a urea breath test. So remember, this shell that it forms around it, it's made of urea, which is this gas that we can measure by a special test. Or you can do a stool test. You can actually look for the bugs in your stool. Or you can do an endoscopy where you actually take a camera and look in the stomach, take a biopsy and find it there. You want to do that endoscopy in patients who also have some other things going on, like some other alarm features. So in addition to the H. pylori, you're looking for something else, right?
Yes.
So when we find the H. pylori, it is very important that we want to eradicate it. So you want to make sure that when you're being treated for H. pylori, you follow up and check that it's gone. So either by repeat testing, you maybe don't want to have to do the endoscopy again, but you can do a breath test or the stool test. And there's certain things that have to be in place before testing for that, because you can have false positives or false negatives. And I want to drive home the point that eradication is essential because H. pylori has a strong connection with stomach cancer. You had Dr. Wellesley Francis on before. I'm not sure if you guys got to talk about stomach cancer, but a lot of patients with stomach cancer also have H. pylori. So finding it earlier, perhaps, this may not have been in the pipeline for those patients.
Well, I know a lot of studies have shown that H. pylori is more prolific in lower socioeconomic groups, and particularly in developing countries.
And that's us.
Yeah,
we are a developing country.
Very much so. But is there any positive role within the body for H. pylori? I mean, why do we not just eradicate all H. pylori? I mean, I know studies I've read in the past that show that possibly eradicating all H. pylori can lead to there is a hypothesis possibly autoimmune disorders or even asthma. So if it has a role and can potentially lead to gastric cancer, it can have a role with gastritis, inflammation, why don't we just eradicate everybody? Why don't we just give everybody triple therapy?
So that's a good question. If you asked me this 5 years ago, the answer was, no, we look for it and then treat it. And then patients would ask, well, if I have it, that means my spouse has it or my household has it. And the guidelines didn't really point towards us testing households and treating.
Okay, oh. We have a call. Welcome to the show. This is Urologist Speaks.
Hey. Yes, thank you, sir and madam. Good evening to you both.
Good evening. Good evening.
My question is, based on the discussion, whether the public service, the public hospital, the Ministry of Health, the hospital authority, whether they have accommodation to take care of patients with any of the concerns, any and all of the concerns.
Very much so, but I'll let Dr. Gemma Rowe answer that.
Now, is that question specific to the topic of H. pylori?
Yes, yes, and everything that has to do, we're correct. That's the bowel, and the bowel was gone on healthy bacteria. That is
no. So, H. pylori We're talking about when H. pylori turns bad, right? It has deleterious or negative effects on the body. It can cause stomach cancer. Can we actually test for this at the public hospital? Right now, the only way that we would know a patient has H. pylori in the public system would be by endoscopy. And again, not everyone gets an endoscopy just to rule out H. pylori. Some other things have to have an endoscopy. But the urea breath test and the stool test are not available at the public hospital, unfortunately.
That's and why is that so? Sorry, but you're not a policymaker, but I'm just asking you that question.
Well, there's a number of tests that are not available in the public system. And H. pylori screening is one of them. Now, there is a blood test, okay, that can be performed as well. But we have to make sure that we're screening, we're using the blood test in patients that we can confirm have either never been treated or exposed to medications that are used to treat H. pylori. But the breath test and the stool test are not available in the public system. Now, when you visit a physician in the public system, there are certain questions that may be asked. And because H. pylori is so common here, you may meet a certain criteria to say, well, treating you for H. pylori and see what happens. So it would be beneficial for the patient to, once they are treated, what we call empirically, right? So there's a suspicion. There's some, and you treat for H. pylori, follow up. Let the physician know, hey, I'm not feeling better, and they may refer you on to the specialty clinic. Or even if you are feeling better, perhaps you that information would be useful as well.
Thank you for your wonderful question. We have another call coming in.
Hello.
Good evening. This is Urologist Speaks.
I wanted to, if you could talk a little about that acid reflux, because I noticed it myself at nighttime. I have to sleep very elevated on pillows because during a flat lay, I find myself choking while I am sleeping, and that's like some, it's like a weird taste has come out to my throat, and I start choking. I have to keep like stuff in the back or like that.
Well, that's a very, very, very common problem, and that's one of the reasons, one of many that I wanted Dr. Gemmerol to come and try and provide relief for hundreds of adults and kids out there who suffer needlessly with GI issues. So I'll put the ball in the expert's hand.
All right, so let's just think about what acid reflux is. So acid reflux is just that, the reflux of acid into the esophagus. The esophagus is a place where acid should not be. At the bottom of the esophagus, there's something called a sphincter that opens to allow food into the stomach. This sphincter also closes to prevent food from going back into the esophagus, including acid. So there are certain things that would cause this sphincter to become loose or incompetent. Certain foods, that would be chocolate, mint, certain hormones, which is why pregnant women have a tendency towards heartburn and reflux when pregnant. And also just pressure in the abdomen. When your stomach is full of air, acid goes in the wrong direction. You're wearing tight-fitted clothing, acid goes in the wrong direction. You eat late at night and you lie down. Or let's not even say late at night. You lay down within 2 hours, 2 to 4 hours of your last meal. You have acid in your stomach to digest the food that you just ate. It takes about 4 hours to empty the stomach. So if you go and lay down, gravity itself is going to cause for acid to go in the wrong direction, right? And so when acid gets into the esophagus lays in the chest. You may have chest pain. This could be discomfort. This can be burning. And that acid getting into, let's say, the back of the throat. This is where the nocturnal or nighttime cough comes in, because acid is allowed to get into, let's say, the mouth. And then called globus sensation, a funny sensation in the mouth. Feels like you have a hot potato, perhaps, in the back of your mouth. So we can either... Now, I didn't speak about the other cause. So we have an incompetent or a sphincter that's not working so well at the bottom of the esophagus, and then we have too much acid in the stomach. So what's going to contribute to the acid stomach? Foods that have spices, citrus products, the lime, the grapefruit, the orange, then tomato-based products, and that's from fresh tomato to cooked, marinara sauce, spaghetti sauce, ketchup, hot sauce, of course. And then you have alcohol that's also going to contribute to the acid and also loosen the sphincter at the bottom of the esophagus. So all of these things contribute to either too much acid or acid being able to go in the wrong direction. So you can either adjust your diet and your lifestyle. You can lose weight. You can not lay down within 2 to 4 hours of a meal. And I'm talking about even eating a biscuit. Right? It requires acid to digest. So you can adjust these things. Now, then there's medications. The medications that you take suppress acid production. You would take that first thing in the morning on an empty stomach, 30 minutes before a meal. That's when it works best. You're not intended to be on this forever because acid is important to digest and to absorb certain vital vitamins and minerals. So you don't want to chronically just be on acid suppression, right? You want to treat the reflux, if this is reflux, for the defined or finite period of time. And then you go on about your business, adjusting your diet and lifestyle. Now, I appreciate that you feel that you have acid reflux. As a matter of fact, the way that you described it is perhaps classic and consistent. But there are a lot of patients who use the term acid reflux probably inaccurately, right? All things that's chest pain, all things that is trouble swallowing or painful swallowing, all things that's a cough is not acid reflux, okay? So I would still encourage patients to talk to their physician and have them tease out certain things that we can, you know, determine the best course of action and management for you.
Dr. Gemmerle, is there any correlation between hiatal hernia and the symptoms you're describing?
Great question. So a hiatal hernia is where the proximal or the upper part of the stomach is in the chest, essentially above the diaphragm. So that sphincter that I spoke about is just at the entrance to the stomach or where the diaphragm would lie. And so that sphincter can be higher up in the chest. So what does that mean? That means the top part of the stomach would be in an area where it shouldn't be, and perhaps if there's acid there above the diaphragm in the chest area, sure, you may have the same symptoms. Well, you may have acid reflux and other things, right? You can have indigestion or just, you know, you eat food and you feel like the food is just sitting on your chest. That may be a symptom of a hiatal hernia.
And when we talk about the symptoms, we're talking black tarry stools and melena stools. When you have severe epigastric pain, should you go to the emergency room? What is the threshold?
That's tough because I don't want anyone sitting out there at home with melena, blood in the stool, saying that, whoa, well, Dr. Gemmerle said I don't have to go to the emergency room.
Well, let's say you're bringing up blood.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. That's an emergency. That's an alarm symptom. That requires an endoscopy. That requires a camera going in and looking to see where you're bleeding from. For the majority of times, you'll stop bleeding, right? But you still want to know where you bled from because the big C word, okay? It's our duty as healthcare providers, physicians, to make sure that you not only get taken care of in the immediate time period, but to make sure, you know, we have to prognosticate. We have to be okay moving forward. Just, you know, take a pill and call me in the morning. alarm features like vomiting blood, passing blood in your stool, you should be seen urgently by a physician and triaged appropriately.
Well, unfortunately, a lot of men I know, and we as a nation, consume far too high intake of alcohol, and there's so many ill health effects of that. I know men who binge drink, not only just on the weekends, but throughout the week, and they'll only stop when they're vomiting blood.
Oh, so, did they stop? You think they stop?
Well, I think they're frightened to stop, yes.
For a little bit.
So when we talk about esophageal varices, we talk about what is relation with alcohol intake?
Doc.
I'm putting you on the spot, but you're the expert. I'll give you some time to think about that one, and we'll talk about it more on the other end of the commercial. This is with Bahamian urologist Dr. Greggory Pinto and my esteemed guest, Bahamian gastroenterologist Dr. Gemma Rule.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fooled with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't back down for nothing. So that means you got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you on?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. You gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, sino.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
All right, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say, I don't want nobody calling me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know, and nobody gotta know it's you.
So how do I wait?
All you gotta do is call them, or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me?
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami, and they don't ask nothing about you. Then if you get the pen from them, and you can claim a reward later using that same pen.
Plus, everything's scrambled, so nobody can...
88477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
It turns out that there is more than one special gift to give that special someone this Christmas. Consumers are searching for the perfect presents and the right prices. So why not place your products or services in the Nassau Guardians Holiday Gift Guide? And this year's Christmas shoppers will be sure to find that special something for everyone on their list.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Welcome back. This Urologist Speaks. We're very pleased to have in the house, the studio tonight, gastroenterologist Dr. Gemma Rule. We were talking about our alcohol consumption, which is a problem in the varices and upper GI bleed and alcohol cirrhosis, liver cirrhosis. Why, if you know somebody who's drinking 6, 8, 10 beers a night, as a gastroenterologist, what can you do to scare them and have put some sense into them?
So when we talk about bleeding varices, first of all, varices are dilated blood vessels in the esophagus caused by pressure built up in what we call the portal system, basically the liver, let's say. And these blood vessels, if there's so much pressure in them because of the liver disease, they can burst. It's like bursting a pipe and it just bleeds. And this can be a nightmare, not just for the patient because it's almost like a murder scene, but for even, you know, a gastroenterologist who's called in the middle of the night for someone that is exsanguinating essentially because varices can just pour out blood. You can bleed to death. So what causes liver disease? A number of things, but as you mentioned, alcohol, drinking alcohol on a regular basis, or maybe too much alcohol, or even just the alcohol binges can cause chronic liver disease. You don't even have to have cirrhosis to have complications from decompensated chronic liver disease.
And I mean, alcoholism leads to increased cancers and many other cancers, so that, and GI cancers as well. So everything in moderation. I spoke last week about men in particular, self-medicating with alcohol and the mm-hmm. dangers associated. So there are outlets that are positive. You need to, if you need help, if you have some post-traumatic stress, if you're dealing with the pressures of life, don't self-medicate with alcohol, because all you're doing is causing another problem on top of another problem, and you'll never get out of it. You don't want to die at the bottom of a bottle. So let's talk about something a little bit more pleasant in terms of, let's prevent colon cancer. What are the risk factors for colon cancer? How can we prevent colon cancer? And what is the role of routine in screening colonoscopies?
So, of course, with any cancer, living a healthy lifestyle is certainly one way to decrease the risk of cancer, especially diet rich in fiber, low in red meat.
Nicotine smoking, of course.
Well, right. Sedentary your alcohol lifestyle. And smoking and being active would be helpful. But let's think about the risk factors that are not modifiable, those that are inherited, your genes. You have colon cancer or other GI cancers in your germline and in your family tree. So, you know, as healthy as you can be, great. But if it's in your family line, you would need to take, I mean, everyone has to take their steps.
So if you have Crohn's disease, if you have ulcerative colitis, do you have an increased risk of
certainly
colon cancer?
Inflammatory bowel disease, which is, like you said, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, those are risk factors for colon cancer, even beyond the average risk or prior to the average risk age of 45. So previously, 50 years, think about screening for colon cancer, but across the board, everyone gets screened for colon cancer at the age of 45. And certainly persons who have an increased risk above the average risk would get screened earlier. Family history of colon cancer, a first degree relative with colon cancer, or an advanced polyp.
And what is the role of CT scan virtual colonoscopies?
So there's various modalities to screen for colon cancer. You have to choose what is best for you along with your physician, okay? The gold standard of screening is going to be with a routine colonoscopy. A colonoscopy which a scope or a tube goes into the rectum. It's an actual camera that goes into the rectum, into the colon, that at the same time, if anything is found, it can remove the colonscope. We can use that to remove any growths or biopsy, take pictures of actual abnormalities in the colon. We do this every 10 years if the colonoscopy is normal. So the CT colonography that you mentioned, or virtual colonoscopy, or you can call it a 3D colonoscopy, it's like a CAT scan. That doesn't require, let's say, sedation like a routine colonoscopy does. This is just a scan that would, you know, create these images of the inside of your bowel and alert us if there is an abnormality found. If it's normal, we do this every 5 years. So when you think about how often we have to do a screening test, it somewhat speaks to I guess the value, the more bang for your buck you would have with these screening modalities. So something that you would do every 5 years is probably not as good as something that you can get away with every 10 years. So a virtual colonoscopy or CT colonography or 3D colonoscopy, that's done every 5 years if it's normal.
And then I guess the advantage of actual colonoscopy is that it can be both diagnostic and therapeutic.
Correct. Yeah. That's why it's the gold standard.
And I mean, a common question that persons would have is, are all polyps cancerous?
So there's different types of polyps. So the polyps that we're looking for that can cause colon cancer is called an adenoma or adenomatous polyp, right? And these are the ones that a routine colonoscopy is best at discovering, because not only because of its size, Just the way that it looks. They can be flat. They can be what we call sessile, that may not be easily picked up by the other modalities, right? Yeah.
So essentially what you're saying is that getting a routine colonoscopy, removing a precancerous polyp, can actually prevent colon cancer.
Correct. Again,
so that should be a motivation.
That should be a motivation.
Yeah.
You know, it's a gold standard. Now, with any modality that you choose, there's going to be pros, cons, risks, benefits, right? You think about some of the downsides of doing a colonoscopy. It's a missed day of work. You have to have the day off. You get sedated.
Well, I think the worst part, which we'll describe when doing colonoscopy, is the prep. And I think they're more gentler preps, if I can use that word, that are...
Mm-hmm. So there are preps that you drink 2 cups of something and just a bunch of water, if you may, or whatever liquid you choose, and you can use that as a bowel prep. In my experience, I haven't seen it work as good as that gallon, that colite. For those of us that have had our colonoscopy already, we know that word. We know colite, go lightly, new lightly, however it's called. It's this big gallon of a solution that you're asked to drink over a 4-hour period. Now, the good thing is that you can split that 4 hours in two. It's recommended that you split it in two. So the closer you are to the time of your colonoscopy, the better to drink the second half.
Okay.
So that's really the most dreadful part of having a colonoscopy. But guess what? When you have a virtual colonoscopy, if you want a really good clean out, you have to do the same thing.
Yeah.
Right? You have to clean out for that as well.
Then when we talk about other non-invasive tests and we're looking for blood or DNA changes that are present in colorectal cancers or lesions, we talk about Cologuard or other tests.
Cologuard, yes.
What is the false positive? What is the false negative rate? Is it predictive of colon cancer? Must you have blood in your stool for there to be colon cancer?
Correct. Good question. So you don't have to have any symptoms at all. You can have a big colon cancer sitting there and it's not bleeding at all. So a FIT test or the stool test that is available in the public system, and it is our national screening test for colon cancer. It's a stool test that you have annually. So here you have a colonoscopy that you can do every 10 years if it's normal. The FIT test or the FOBT, it's really the FIT test that we use that is more specific to human blood, because the older test can test for any type of blood. Even if you had like red meat, it will pick it up. But the FIT test is more specific to human blood, and you would have to send in 3 samples, and again, with the hopes that at some point you'll find this microscopic or occult blood in the stool, and you send that in every year. And if it's positive, then you need a colonoscopy. So it's really sensitive to picking up blood, but again, not all cancers actually bleed, and so cancers can be missed. And when you think about polyps, it is not sensitive, not as sensitive. We're talking about 30% or less to pick up advanced polyps, okay? The colonoscopy is the one that's going to give you above a 90% sensitivity to pick up the polyps. So it's not just cancer we're looking for. We're looking for polyps. And that same goes for Cologuard. Cologuard is a test that looks for DNA of a tumor, of a colon cancer in the stool. So we want to know if we have polyps as well. The Cologuard really isn't going to give us that information.
Okay. And when we talk about... let's limit our risk of getting colon cancer, and we want to start from young. So on this show, I always try to promote preventative medicine. So we talk about diet. Diet is very important for every system in our body in preventing cancers, preventing heart disease.
Mm-hmm.
What, should we be vegan? Should we all white meat? Should we sparingly have red meat? In regards to GI malignancies, what is your advice?
Yeah, sparing. You said it all, like sparingly the red meat. Okay. I mean that's difficult. If you look at the food pyramid, all the foods that we should be eating on a daily basis, all of the foods that we should have the majority of is at the bottom of that pyramid. All the fruits and the vegetables and the grains. That's really, I guess, what we were intended to consume. So diets that are high in saturated fats, the red meat, less pick a fast food chain. I don't want to say I need to get in trouble, but let's pick a fast food chain. We pull up to the drive-through. What on that menu can we eat that would be in an effort to eat healthy and prevent any type of cancer? I think the only thing that is available there is maybe the salad, right? And without the dressing, because that dressing these saturated fats. That if you ever scoped a patient, look in their stomach, and they just recently had a meal, all of those oil and greasy droplets are just sitting and floating there. And just, you know, to think about where it's going to go, it's not a good thought. We absorb these things. They cause free radical formation and bad stuff.
Well, when we talk about the very high incidence of colorectal cancer in this country, both male and female, obviously we'll look at, well, you said diet, our sedentary lifestyle.
Obesity. Fat in itself.
What about 1 in 7 Bahamian residents are either pre-diabetic or diabetic?
Ugh.
Is there a link between diabetes and colorectal cancer?
Not as well defined, but certainly the metabolic syndrome contributes to an environment that feeds, right, causes the proliferation of cancer. You have a lot of sugar floating around. Let's keep it simple, right? So you have a lot of sugar because you're not able to process it. You're a diabetic. That sugar is feeding a cancer, right?
Yes, very much so.
Yeah.
So when we're trying to be preventative, obviously diet is important. We need to start a colonoscopy, you said, every 10 years starting at 45.
Yes.
And
if it's normal.
Yes. And then even for, we have a aging population, if you have longevity, if you're very fit,
yeah.
We'll even go beyond 75.
So we can. There's guidelines that tell us to stop at 75 because the next one you'll do is at 85. And then what are we looking for? What is the life expectancy of this patient? Who's the oldest that I've scoped for screening? And 100-year-old when I was in fellowship in New York City, right? 100-year-old and his spouse at 101 I scoped. Yeah. Right? But it's up to the individual at times. I mean, if there are contraindications to scoping, if you're probably going to die sooner from something else, you don't have to get your screening colonoscopy. Okay. But if you're still, like we said, swinging golf at 80, come on in and get your colonoscopy. Get screened.
Okay. So let's talk about another very common problem that even I will see as a urologist, even from kids in elementary school or younger going up. Through adults, through all ages, and that's constipation.
Whew.
That's something that so many members of our society are plagued with, and
mm-hmm.
it completely deteriorates the quality of life
for children
as well.
Mm-hmm.
What can we do to avoid constipation? Let's start with kids. There are a lot of kids that even have urinary issues because a rectum full of stool is pressing, causing extrinsic compression on the bladder and giving that overactive bladder syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
How do we treat, unless there's a, let's just rule out the rare causes, anatomical or functional disorders. Let's just talk about.
So the anatomical disorders you're going to see pretty early on, right?
Correct.
As a baby, like we're talking about Hirschsprung's disease,
yes.
Right? Where the anus is, you know, not fully or malformed.
Well, I think let's start with constipation. I mean, everybody's
great.
Different.
Good.
How often should you pass to?
So,
people it's 3 times a day. Some people it's every third day.
Yes.
What is normal?
That number 3 is the magical number, right?
Okay.
So we're thinking about not only the frequency of having a bowel movement, but the ease in which that bowel movement occurs, right? So constipation can also be defined as what maneuvers or pressure that you have to apply to pass the stool. The consistency of your stool. If you have pebbles and rock hard stool, though you're passing that every day, this can be deemed as constipation, right? The process of which, the ease of which you can have that bowel movement should be considered as well. So when we think about the frequency, 3 times a day to even 3 times a week is considered normal.
If it's normal for somebody every day and then all of a sudden it goes to every third day, is that a concern?
So that could be a cause for concern, right? Or if you know you're having a bowel movement every other day, and then a week has passed, you haven't had a bowel movement, and on top of it, you're not feeling well. But you have to think about on a day-to-day basis, we eat differently every day. Sometimes it can be as simple as a change in your diet. You're eating a little less fiber. You're having a little less...
Or medication. There are some medications that notoriously cause constipation.
Correct.
Or delayed
blood pressure medication.
Yeah, correct.
Taking iron. People who just feel fatigued and they grab iron off of the shelf and they say that, you know, my iron is low, and they start taking iron and then the constipation sets in, right? Not drinking enough water, change in activity. When we go away, we are less likely to have as freely a movement, right? When we think about the back to the children, sometimes it's situational. Even in adults, some adults do not have bowel movements outside of their own bathroom. So when you don't answer the call and you repeatedly do this to your bowel, not answering the call because you are not in the comfort of your home, you are training your bowel to not move.
And the poorly controlled diabetics, why do they have problems with constipation?
Well, the same reason that they may have problems with erections, right? The
very
nerves
so.
Are affected.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that should also be a warning sign of something going on. Always, and because we have such an overwhelming incidence of diabetes, we got to rule that out. If you're diabetic, it might be that fact that you're not well controlled, or you may be undiagnosed diabetic. So we always have to look at if there's anything wrong, always seek help. Men notoriously don't do it. Women are a little bit better. But if you have a problem and you feel that something is you just don't feel right. Yeah, you're feeling bloated. You're losing weight, or we'll even talk about the other end of the spectrum. What is the problem with, or what are some of the causes? Every time you have any meal, you have intestinal hurry. You're having diarrhea.
Mm. It could be diabetes too. I mean, diabetes, you know.
I know from my days of general surgery, that can also be that you may have a mass, and the only thing that could get past that mass is the stool. So always, if there's any change, and that's the question we as the physicians always pose to our patients, is there any
change in your
bowel
habits? Yes.
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 And you need to think back. Is there being anything that's alarming? And you need to be forthcoming. There's no point in withholding information that can potentially save your life when you're seeing a physician in a environment where confidentially everything can be said and stays in that office.
Yes.
I mean, we're both in subspecialties that there are a lot of embarrassing symptoms and complaints that a lot of patients will suffer for years before they come to us. But they have to know that everything,
it's a safe space.
We've heard it all. We're not going to judge anybody. We want to help people. We're not going to carry that information outside of the office. But the biggest crying shame, and I keep saying that, is to suffer needlessly. And don't let embarrassment cause you to have a deterioration in the quality of your life or to prevent you from getting early cancer that metastasized. And if you didn't want to see a doctor once a year, imagine if you had metastatic disease. You're going to be in and out of hospital. You're going into renal failure, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If you don't want to get pricked or getting blood taken, or you don't want to be in an emergency room, then at least take 1 hour a year to get your annual physicals.
Yes, yes.
Preventative medicine is what we're speaking here, and that's what we're trying to be proactive and not reactionary. Obviously, if something's going on, we want to react as swiftly as possible to provide a cure for whatever early stage of disease it is, whether it's a non-communicable disease like hypertension or diabetes. But if it's related to whatever cancer, we want to be able to pick it up, because the earlier we can pick up a disease,
the better
in terms of our outlook for that patient. So we did talk briefly about inflammatory bowel disease. And unfortunately, and I've seen a lot of patients suffer with ulcerative colitis, with Crohn's disease.
Good question. So Crohn's disease ulcerative colitis is limited to the colon. Colitis, it's just inflammation of the lining of the colon. Crohn's disease can happen at any point in the GI tract, from the mouth to the anus. So you can have Crohn's in your stomach, in your mouth, at the anus. You can have fistula formation. in the anus. So that's, you know, the main difference. And then Crohn's disease goes into the deeper layers of the lining of the digestive tract. And the ulcerative colitis is just pretty much on the inner surface of the colon. Both of them can have extra intestinal manifestations where you just have inflammation of joints, the skin. But inflammatory bowel disease, which is the umbrella name for both of these conditions, is where there is an autoimmune immune system attacks the digestive tract. It's an autoimmune condition of the gut. And if, you know, for persons who may not understand what autoimmune disease is, it's sort of like, well, lupus, for example. Lupus is where the immune system attacks small blood vessels. Unfortunately, blood vessels are in all organ systems. So lupus can affect almost every organ system. Another autoimmune condition is thyroid disease, right? Thyroiditis. You can have autoimmune thyroiditis.
I think I'd be remiss, and there's always a lot of confusion, and even for many laypersons, is there a difference between irritable bowel and inflammatory bowel?
Big difference, right? So irritable bowel syndrome is just, let's think about it, just your bowel is irritated. The reason for the irritation, there's this thing called the brain-gut axis. The brain controls everything. And the connection between the brain and the gut, when something goes wrong and the signal causes irritable bowel syndrome, there is a criteria that we use to make a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome. You have to have abdominal pain or discomfort that is associated with a change in your bowel habits. And that can be constipation or diarrhea, or it can be mixed. They can alternate. And another key feature of that may or may not be present is that your discomfort or your pain is relieved when having a bowel movement. Okay. So that is IBS. Most patients, or a lot of patients, come in self-diagnosed. They go to Dr. Google and they put in their symptoms and it shoots out IBS, okay? Now, IBS and IBD can overlap. Inflammatory bowel disease and irritable bowel syndrome can overlap, but they are very separate. There is danger in self-diagnosing IBS in a patient who is above the age of 45. We do not make a diagnosis of IBS in patients that have not had screening for colon cancer above the age of 45 there. For my physicians, for my colleagues that already know that, I'm just sending a reminder, IBS should not be diagnosed in a patient who has not been screened for colon cancer. IBS does not cause rectal bleeding. If there is bleeding as a part of your syndrome, it's not IBS.
Oh, we were talking about the ill effects of overconsumption of alcohol, and we were remiss in mentioning pancreatitis. What is pancreatitis and what is the role of alcohol in pancreatitis?
You are covering it all. So pancreatitis is a burn in the belly. It's where the pancreas is on fire in the abdomen.
And what is the role of the pancreas?
The pancreas is a part of the digestive tract that produces a couple hormones and enzymes for digestion, lipase, right? This digests fats. That's the role of the pancreas in digestion. But the pancreas, of course, is where you're going to get insulin, right? So when you have pancreas problems, you may have insulin problems, you may have diabetes. But sticking with digestion, the exocrine, what we call it, function of the pancreas is to produce enzymes to digest the fats that we eat. When you have alcohol, too much alcohol, you can have an inflamed or an inflammation of your pancreas. This is a very dangerous condition to have, right? People can die from acute pancreatitis because in 48 hours, you can have other organ systems that become infected from this burn in your belly.
So I should have mentioned that this is obviously an interactive show. We appreciate your calls, and I wouldn't want you to miss the opportunity to ask questions of the very learned and esteemed Dr. Gemma Rohl. You can call us here at 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 326-4259 or call toll-free from the Family Islands at 242 300-5720. We'll talk more on the other end of the break. Neurologist Dr. Greggory Pinto.
And impactful printing services, look no further. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life. We stand by our quality products that is second to none. Our affordable pricing and friendly, efficient staff makes Printmasters the ultimate choice for all your printing needs. We can deliver any type of printing services, from banners to booklets to business cards. You name it, we can print it.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located at the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
Always on the go? Missed a show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Studio, Dr. Gemma Roll, gastroenterologist. We have an incoming call.
Hi.
Good evening. This is Urologist Speaks. Welcome.
Hi. Good evening. I just want to tell you that your show is very informative.
Thank you.
I would have listened, and I thank you both for all the information you've shared thus far. I do have a question, though. I work in banking, and there's at least... three or four persons in my office, including myself, who from time to time is almost regularly having acid reflux. When would you say that a person would need to actually come in and see a professional that is, or an expert, to get an assessment based on, because I do know that acid reflux can be damaging as well.
Well, obviously, this goes to Dr. Gemmerle, but as a physician, as a surgeon, urologist, obviously, it seems like it's affecting your quality of life. Obviously, yeah, you can put you at risk for it in itself condition, but if it's affecting you socially, professionally, if you're concerned, I always advocate any concern whatsoever. There's no stupid reason to go and see a physician. So I'll let Dr. Gemmerle speak in more depth.
So acid reflux or GERD is a very common complaint in our population. And as we stated earlier, you know, diet and lifestyle can play a significant role, and even stress. You work in banking. I would imagine that might be stressful. You can first present to your primary care physician with your complaints. And here is where you would get screened, or certain symptoms may be teased out that your primary care physician may say, you know, sounds like we should take a look because there are some atypical features of this acid reflux, right? Or some alarm features. But if it's just, you know, burning in the chest after a meal, based on your lifestyle habits, your physician will opt to encourage diet and lifestyle, as well as, or eventually treat you with actually prescribed medication known as a proton pump inhibitor that will decrease the acid in your stomach. And once that is decided, you should probably be on that medication consistently for 2 to 4 weeks. With return to your physician after being off of it, to follow up to update them on how you are feeling. If your symptoms persist and you are doing what you have to do to prevent acid reflux, you may be referred to a gastroenterologist for consideration of an endoscopy. That's after you know, you've been treated. But you can also choose to see a specialist at any time. I mean, this is free will. You can go in to see a gastroenterologist and they would tease out your symptoms and see whether or not there's anything alarming. And by alarming, I mean you feel that you have trouble swallowing because food is getting stuck. You have painful vomiting blood. You're passing blood in your stool. Perhaps,
You can even have decay of your dentition from the acid reflux when it gets really bad. I know the cases of that. But should patients be taking proton pump inhibitors? There's some patients who are taking Nexium twice
forever.
A day for years.
Yeah, no. So, no. That's pretty much probably not a good thing to do because acid is important to absorb vitamins and minerals, okay? And certain people who are at risk for osteoporosis, osteopenia, are you absorbing the vitamin D, the calcium that you should? As well as, again, acid is important to kill bacteria in the stomach. If you are chronically acid suppressed, there is a theory that you may be more prone to infections of the gut. So no, being on Nexium or Pentacto, Gastro, Prevacid, Prilosec, Alicid, all of these things every single day for years is probably not a good thing.
Are there those who walk around
in the pocket
or they're popping Tums like they're candy?
Yeah.
I mean, that's very concerning. What is the role of imaging when you suspect a hiatal hernia? Because that can be causing all the symptoms. How common are hiatal hernias?
You know, I wouldn't give hiatal hernias that much credit for much, right? The hiatal hernias that perhaps should be considered for repair would be those that have a good portion of your stomach, maybe in the chest, and, you know, the patient is regurgitating a lot or really uncomfortable.
What about in terms of, there's a lot of promotion for allergy testing of food. So certain.
Yeah, it is controversial,
yes.
Right? Because there's something called like the ALCAT test.
Yes.
And maybe there are others, but there's different degrees to which you can be tested for these allergens.
But there's some persons who swear by it. They'll say, okay, they have to cut this out and they don't have any symptoms anymore.
And that's great for them, right? But what if you've eaten an apple every day of your life, no
correct.
Problems,
yeah.
And your ALCAT tells you that you have severe reaction to apples.
Yes.
Well, what do you do with that information?
Correct. Well, we have another call. Oh, sorry, we just lost that call. So, yeah, what about gluten intolerance and allergies?
Yeah, so gluten is this little protein that's found in wheat, barley, rye, right, predominantly. There is a condition called celiac disease, tropical sprue, celiac sprue, where the consumption of gluten causes destruction of the small bowel, and so patients would have abdominal pain, discomfort, et cetera.
Okay, let's take this call. Good evening.
Good evening, Dr. Pinto, and your guest.
Thank you for calling in.
I have a question, right? When I was growing up, right, my parents had this habit of every summer after school, they would give us laxatives like cenepads, Epsom salts, sometimes even castor oil. Is such a practice good?
So we're talking about the routine use of laxatives.
Yeah,
and this is
like
once a year during the summer?
Yeah, every summer, right? You know, they make sure they give us laxatives.
Is that an everyday thing or is it just
once a year?
Just once.
Yes.
So let's be reminded that the colon is a self-cleansing organ, right? Every time you have a bowel movement, you're cleaning out your bowel, right? Doing something that like that is perhaps not clinically necessary or there isn't like a medical per se benefit to doing something like that. If you have been doing that, if you have that in your practice, you know, I wouldn't say that you're doing harm, right? Because it's just a once a year thing. But chronic or frequent use of laxatives that clean out the bowel, stimulant laxatives, can cause harm.
I mean, I listen to patients and always I'll get a history from them. Do you have any change in bowel habits? Do you have any constipation, diarrhea, weight loss? And they'll say, no, doc, I use a suppository every day.
Yeah, exactly. Isn't that crazy? Well, I'm not a diabetic because I take the medication.
Yes, exactly.
My blood pressure isn't high because I take the medication.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So is stooling too much? You have 4 meals a day. within half an hour, you got to seal four times.
Four, you mean?
Every time you eat, you must
have a bowel movement?
You have to have a bowel movement.
That's physiologically ideal. That's okay.
Okay.
You know, we're talking about a formed stool.
Okay.
Something that takes a shape, and you just have a bowel movement. There's no pain and there's no urgency to have this. It's just, you know, you have a reflex, a gastrocolic reflex. You eat and you have a bowel movement. That's good.
We were talking earlier about modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors for colon cancer, and then we never really spoke about the genetics. There are actually genetic conditions that predispose you, and it runs in families. Are you a proponent for actual genetic testing for families that have high numbers of their members with colon cancer, particularly at a younger age?
So the cost of genetic testing might be prohibitive, right? And I don't want to incite fear in patients who they know they have a family history of certain cancers for genetic testing. So I'm not necessarily a strong proponent of, right? But I am a strong proponent of knowing that you have a family history of a particular cancer, seeing your physician and figuring out when is a good time to be screened.
Then we talk about why do we have such high incidence of breast cancer, prostate cancer, colon cancer. Do you think a small genetic pool has a role?
Well, certainly a lot of research and studies have been done with the breast cancer. You know, definitely they say, you know, something's in the water in the Bahamas. And I think globally we have an appreciation for that. I don't think that colon cancer is kind of on the same level as the situation with the breast cancer. I don't think so.
Have you seen any differences in terms of the ages of persons diagnosed with colorectal cancer in the United States where you worked or in the Bahamas? Are we getting struck with colon cancer at an earlier age or a more advanced form of the disease? Are we picking them up later?
I think that it's similar. When it was being said that African Americans should be screened earlier at 45. This was a time when 50 was the number. So coming home, I knew that people that looked like me should probably get screened at 45. And it kind of worked my practice like that. And then a few years ago, suddenly that was great for everybody to be screened at 45. Do we have patients who present in their 20s with advanced colon cancer, colon and rectal cancer? Yes. Is it frequent? You know, I'm one of five gastroenterologists. I'm sure we have our share of them, and probably one is too much.
Yes, of course.
So again, not to incite fear in patients, but things like rectal bleeding is never normal. Self-diagnosing with gas, everything is gas. They have a pain. It's because of something I ate. We always eat bad. So how do you differentiate? When there's something along, you know, kind of go and get checked out. So again, I probably can't say that, yes, we're being inundated with a lot of young persons with colon cancer. I can probably count them on my hands, but you kind of remember them because they're so young. Do I see patients with advanced polyps at a young age? And I'm just happy that they had their colonoscopy earlier for some other reason and you incidentally find the polyp. Yes, I'm seeing a lot of that.
Well, we're in the tropics. We're talking about kids, adults, all ages. What about parasitic infestation that falls within the gastrointestinal tract? Do you see...
Oh, my goodness. It's the coolest thing to do a colonoscopy and you see a live worm just wiggling around in there.
So should we deworm our kids routinely?
Sure. Yeah. That's tropical medicine. Yeah. So that's going to be a recommendation.
That goes across the board for adults as well. Or do we wait for symptoms?
It could be a choice that you make.
But should we be proactive and assume that a high predominance?
Well, I don't see kids, right? Mm-hmm. But in terms of adults, it's not something that I promote in my practice. It's a deworm.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay. No. And I must say, for all of my women out there who do not know that colon cancer affects men and women equally.
Yes.
Right? Because there will be women that come to the office with acid reflux or some other complaint. If they're 45, 45 or greater, I'm going to capture, well, have you been screened for colon cancer? And I get the response that that's a man's disease, you know? And I think they're kind of mixing up the prostate with colon. Yes, the prostate can be found in the rectum, okay, or assessed through the rectum, but we all have a colon. So men and women equally are affected by colon polyps and colon cancer.
And then I've always spoken many times on this show and in other forums about BRCA gene. We're talking about the breast cancer gene mutation. Does that predispose us to getting colon cancer? Because I know it causes a increase. Obviously, breast cancer, skin cancer, pancreatic cancer.
Right. So when we think about the colon cancer syndromes, the Lynch syndrome, you can have the breast cancers in that family of patients with Lynch syndrome.
Well, I thank you very much for having the learned and esteemed Dr. Gemma Roll, our famous Bahamian gastroenterologist in the studio today. We went through a wealth of information.
Everything.
Yes.
Yes.
But,
thank you so much
for
having me,
we must bring
Doc.
You back
yes.
to talk to you
as your president
of the MAB.
The
yes.
Medical Association
so
of the
So we
Bahamas.
Want to know, what is your viewpoint on the medical landscape presently,
yeah, the
future,
new hospital, NHI.
So we will bring you back. That's going to be a hot topic.
Yes.
Thank
great.
You very much. And thank you for all our valued listeners. I'm always encouraged everywhere I go, whether it's a food store or even in my office, for so many persons looking forward to the show and learning so much from the show. Have a good night, and this is Dr. Greggory Pinto, and thank you, Dr. Gemma Roll.
Yes, thank you.